So what I want to talk about today is, I said there's several types of symmetry that viruses use as their basing building code. And we talked about the icosahedral yesterday, and I just want to go over the helical today, which is, I hope, going to be reasonably simple. Okay, so helical. The classic example of this is a virus called tobacco mosaic virus, because this was the first one solved, and it's a plant virus and doesn't infect us, but it's one of the easiest to see the basic principle in, so I'm going to use it. So the principle in helical viruses is that the nucleic acid, which is shown here as the red stuff, the nucleic acid is actually assembled by interacting with a series of subunits. And they assemble in a spiral fashion, and I'll try and explain that. So this tubing represents the nucleic acid, and these shoes represent the protein subunits. And in fact, in tobacco mosaic virus, they do. They look actually very like shoes, Crocs, if you like. And so if what happens here is the nucleic acid, which would be very susceptible to degradation in the environment if it was just a straight nucleic acid. And so here is a protein subunit that is going to assemble it. And so what happens is the protein subunit binds to the nucleic acid, and then the next subunit binds, and the next subunit binds, and so you get your nucleic acid starting to be protected. If micro had been a bit more generous, I would have more shoes and I could actually assemble something that looked more like this. But you can see, I hope, that if this happened, given the shape of these shoes, what would happen is if I had lots of pairs of shoes, they would eventually cause this to turn around in a spiral. This would start turning, and so you could assemble a long row of the shoes, but because of the shape of the shoes, you would eventually get it curving back on itself, which is what happens in tobacco mosaic virus. So the shoe analogy is not bad for tobacco mosaic virus, or in fact, it turns out for a lot of these other viruses. So if we assembled that, we'd eventually get the shoes coating all of the RNA. The number of shoes would depend on the shoes and the length of the nucleic acid. So in the case of these viruses, the length of the nucleic capsid depends on the length of the nucleic acid inside. Now, if I were to bring the shoes round on the next turn of this, then if the one set of shoes interacted with the other set of shoes very well, because they'd, say, got sort of Velcro-like material on them, this would make for a very stiff spiral. If they didn't interact very well, it would be very floppy, it could easily fall apart. And that's actually what happens with these viruses. Some of them, the turns of the spiral interact very well because the tops and the bottoms of the shoes interact very well. In other cases, it doesn't. And the other thing is, if I had shoes which had got narrower heels, this would be a tighter spiral. If they got broader heels, it would be a less tight spiral, a less small. The width of the axis diameter of the spiral would depend according to the properties of these shoes. So if the heels were very narrow, it would come back on itself very quickly. If they're pretty broad, it would come back on itself more slowly. So you can get all sorts of things that change the pitch of the spiral and everything else according to the property of the shoes. But the basic principle still is that one shoe after another binds as the RNA is assembled into its nuclear capsid, and that determines the properties of this. So if you have a nice tight nuclear capsid where the individual rings interact with each other, it's not covalent, you can pull them apart, but it takes a little bit of effort, you get a slinky. And if you look at it in the electron microscope, what you see is the edge of the slinky with all these nice little fine lines, and you can see that that looks like a helical nuclear capsid. And that's what some of the virus particles look like. And when we come to rabies, if you look at rabies in an electron microscope, it's just like looking at the edge of a slinky. But if you were to take it apart, you could actually see that it's actually just a nice tight spiral. Some of the others have got less good interactions, and they begin to look more like a flash cord. Don't tell my husband I've got his flash cord. But here it is, and so here, this is very floppy, there's not good interaction between the turns of the spiral. Now, here, when you look at the flash coil, what you see is the outside, which is this black material that protects the inside. So the outside would be the protein that comes from the virus-coded protein that makes the capsid, and the inside would be the virus nucleic acid. So together, the cord inside and the protective coating outside is a nuclear capsid. But you can see that if I do it up, I get something that looks very messy, and that's what you would see if you looked inside a, say, a measles virus capsid. These are what measles virus nucleic capsid do. They're floppy. And so they look like a mess in the electron microscope. This looks very pretty, but basically they're the same thing. They're just helical nuclear capsids. And from the outside, you can't see the nucleic acid because it's in there, buried in the protein, and totally protected. Okay. So the length is controlled by the length of the nucleic acid, and as I say, the helix may be stiff or flexible, so it can be the slinky or the telephone cord type of model. Any questions on that? So this is another way to simply assemble a protected long piece of nucleic acid by just having repeating subunits. But instead of having a hollow solid into which you can stuff the nucleic acid, in this case, the nucleic acid is directly interacting with the components of the capsid. Okay. We've got helical symmetry and icosahedral symmetry. And is that all that viruses use? Well, by and large, that seems to be what the vast majority of viruses use. They will fit into one or other of these categories. There's always an exception. And in viruses, the exception is frequently smallpox virus, known as the orthopox. Ortho means right. So these are the true pox viruses. So smallpox and its relative vaccinia pox, which is the one we use for the vaccine, these are the largest of the viruses that we regularly talk about infecting humans, or that at the moment we ever talk about infecting humans. So these are the largest viruses, and they do a lot of things differently. So if there's an exception, these are frequently going to be it. But they have some kind of regular assembly, and I'll show you again later on some pictures of some other members of the pox virus family. And they really seem to have this. This is what the... Well, that is pathetic. This is what the outside of vaccinia actually looks like. Looks a bit of a jumble, but obviously somehow it's got to assemble all these subunits in some way. Some of the other pox viruses look really organized on the outside and very beautiful. And this is a cross-section through, and this is the nuclear capsid in here, and these are some things that we'll come to later called lateral bodies. But it's clearly highly organized, but we don't know what the basic principle is. And so with enormous imagination, we just say this is complex. And we just get rid of everything else by saying they're complex. But that does give us an easy way to at least have some idea of what we're dealing with from its basic structure. And we have to have some way of putting these together into likes and unlikes, not dislikes. Okay, so we have those three basic types of structure. And then, as I say, some of them have an envelope. And the envelope doesn't matter which kind of structure you have inside. These viruses may be enveloped or non-enveloped. And the envelope is obtained by budding through a cellular membrane, with the exception of pox viruses, and we'll come to how they get their envelope a bit later on. But it's, in all cases, it's derived from the host cell membrane. These viruses don't make the membrane for themselves. But one thing about it is, because it comes from pushing through a cellular membrane, if you push through the plasma membrane, and as you push through, you get surrounded by a bubble of plasma membrane as you get out of the cell, and then it seals behind you, and the virus particle is free to go off. But it's now got a cell membrane around it, which already had viral proteins stuck into it. So it's got an outside which has got some viral proteins on, because remember, they need an attachment protein to get into the next cell. So that's got to be on the outside of the virus. So if you get the cell membrane, there's the possibility, it's not always the case, but there's a possibility that you can get out of the cell without killing the cell. So if you can get out of the cell without killing the cell, for the envelope, for the non-envelope viruses, there's no way they can cross a lipid membrane. So the only way they get out of the cell is because the cell eventually dies for one reason or another, and then they get out of the cell. But for the envelope viruses, there's a possibility that they can get out of the cell, and so that they can establish a persistent infection in the cell. So they may release virus particles, quite a few, all the time, or they may just occasionally release a virus particle, but not kill the cell. And we'll come back to this when you hear about herpes viruses from Dr. Gangemi, because they establish a, quote, latent infection, but during that latent infection, they will produce viruses that get out of the cell, just a sort of constant slow bleed of viruses. So the envelope viruses are frequently the viruses that can establish persistent infections. And in some ways, that's not really what you want. You would rather, often, have a sort of nasty little ulcer, or not ulcer, but a nasty little vesicle or something on your finger that disappears, rather than live with the virus for the rest of your life. But in fact, with herpes viruses, once you've got them forever. There's no cure. They will hang around. You may never know you've got them again, but they're there. So these membrane envelope viruses are very regularly established persistent infections. As I say, they have to have at least one virally coded protein in that envelope because they're going to need a virally coded protein to recognize the receptor on the next cell they infect. So this just shows that if you've got an envelope, your attachment protein has to be on the outside of the envelope. Okay, there's another consequence of having an envelope. These envelopes are lipid bilayer membranes, so they're very sensitive to detergent. Detergents include alcohol, soap, bile salts. And so these envelope viruses, with a very few exceptions, so the generalization is that they don't survive the gut, which is why I put this up here. So they don't survive the conditions in the gut. So if you've got a virus that's infecting your GI tract, it's 99% likely to be a non-envelope virus. There is an exception. You'll be hearing about those from Dr. Albrecht next week. There's a Toro, T-O-R-O. Toro viruses are envelope viruses, and they do survive the gut. But it's rare. So by and large, they don't. Now, why should I even be stressing that? Well, one of the things is that this is our best friend this year. And so here's our BFF for this year. And why is it working so well? It's working so well because influenza is an envelope virus. So this stuff works really well because it destroys envelope viruses very readily. If you remove the envelope from a nuclear capsid, you've removed the attachment protein. So the attachment protein could still bind to a cell, but it's not going to have a virus attached to it to get into the cell. So the nuclear capsids have got no way to get into the cell. So this is a really good way to inactivate an envelope virus. But if you've got a non-envelope virus, it's going to do very little to it. So while cleaning your hands is always a good idea, the point is that if you've got a GI tract virus, you're really going to need soap and water to rinse everything off and get it away. Just rubbing with alcohol is not going to be terribly efficient because the virus will still be there at the end of it. So if you're in a daycare nursery with rotaviruses everywhere, and those are standard GI tract, they don't have an envelope, then inactivating that, just wiping surfaces with an alcohol wipe and using hand cleaner is not just going to work nearly as well. So this becomes a question of what sort of things do you need to do. But by and large, if you've got a GI tract infection, it's going to be much more difficult to get rid of it than if you've got influenza, which is why you have all these problems with these noroviruses on cruise ships, much more difficult to inactivate. Okay, so to get back to virus structure, so that leaves us with, you can have viruses which are icosahedral or helical. You can have these enveloped or non-enveloped. So here we've got the icosahedral non-enveloped envelope. We're going to see examples of all of these, so I won't worry you with them now. And then you've got this last one, complex. As far as we're concerned with that, it's really the orthopox viruses, the true pox viruses, smallpox, monkeypox, vaccinia pox, some others that we'll come to. It so happens for the viruses that infect humans, we have none of this class. So you can forget non-enveloped helical. If that's an option on the exam, forget about it. So we're left with these four classes as far as you're concerned, but all classes exist. Are there any questions on viral structure before I go on? Okay. Now, I just want to cover a few things which have no natural home in the syllabus, so I get to cover them. And the first of these, so we call these unconventional agents because they're not bacteria, they're not any other, they're not worms, they're not protozoa, they're not viruses. And the first one I want to cover are viroids. So these are RNA only. So they've only got nucleic acid, it's only RNA, and they've got no proteins to go with them. So they don't count as a virus. Your typical virus has got an attachment protein. Remember, it's a piece of bad news wrapped up in a protein. These have no protein. They are not a problem to you unless you're a coconut tree or something like that, because they are a problem in agriculture, but they're not a problem for humans, as far as we know. And you never say never in this field. So they don't code for a protein. They're too small to code for a protein, actually. And so far, they're only known in plants. So why do I even bother? Well, we have one of these things that's got its feet. Somebody once said one foot in the grave and one on the banana skin. This has got one foot as being just a viroid, one foot as being a virus. And this is important. That's hepatitis delta. So hepatitis delta, nowadays it's being called called a virus because I guess CDC and other people don't want to have to explain to people what the nitty-gritty of this, why it's not a virus. It's not a true virus, but we call it a virus because that just makes life easier. And you're going to hear about this in the hepatitis lectures. But it's called virus, but actually quite frequently you'll find it called hepatitis delta agent. Because, as I say, it's not a true virus. And the interesting thing is it's got a circular genome, RNA, like viroids. And some viroids have got very special secondary structure features of their genome, which actually allow their genome to act as an RNAs. So it's got enzyme activity, which is unusual for RNA. And the same features are seen in hepatitis delta virus. So it looks reminiscent of some of these plant viruses, a subclass of these plant viruses. We don't know whether that's because it's related or it's just pure chance or what it is, but it has been useful in understanding some of it because we actually have seen examples in the plant world. So it's got some features of a viroid. It's small, it doesn't code for a viral attachment protein, so it's not capable of surviving as a virus on its own. It has these special features, but it does code for a protein, so that makes it not a viroid. And the protein it codes for is its capsid protein. So it can package itself, but it can't get out of a cell because it's got no means to it can't establish an infection because it's got no attachment protein. So what does it do? It parasitizes hepatitis B virus. So when hepatitis B virus infects a cell, it's an envelope virus. It makes an envelope into which it puts a viral attachment protein. And this virus just says, oh, great, you know, I've got a package here. And so it uses the hepatitis B envelope. So this is a parasite on hepatitis B. If you don't have hepatitis B virus, this can't do a thing. So when you get vaccinated against hepatitis B, you also get vaccinated against this. Because if you don't have hepatitis B, you don't get this. So it's a parasite on a parasite. And it's in the in-between class. And I just wanted to cover it because we're not really going to cover anything more about its biology, but I just wanted to let you know it's not a true virus. It does things rather differently, and I'm not going to go into what that difference is. It shouldn't be a problem these days because if you can vaccinate against hepatitis B, you can basically protect against this. Unfortunately, we still got quite a bit of hepatitis B around. Any questions on that? Okay. The other thing, which we're also going to come back to at the end of the course, is the extreme. The viroids are nucleic acid only. Prions are believed to be protein only. Now, when I first started giving this lecture, we had about 4 question marks there. And just like the nuclear clock ticks round, this one has been ticking down because I'm getting more and more convinced it really is protein only. But we still have 1 question mark left. It's still slightly controversial, but we're pretty sure that these prions are just protein. So they're an infectious protein. And how you get an infectious protein, we'll discuss in the last lecture in this section. And they don't seem to contain any nucleic acid, so they're the other end of the scale. And we'll come back to those. So they're not viruses either. They've got no genome. Okay, this is my philosophy for the day, and it's going to last for no more than 30 seconds. Are viruses living or dead? And you can all get together and discuss it to yourselves in Starbucks or something. I'm not going to go into the philosophy of this. I just want to point out that you can see viruses. They're just nucleic acid and protein and maybe a bit of an envelope. You can see viruses as either very sophisticated chemical structures or very simple life forms. And that just depends on your definition of life. But what it does explain is why so often when you see people telling you how much virus they've got, they don't say, I've got so many live viruses. The term is used sometimes, but more frequently people say, I've got so many infectious units, I've got so many lethal units. They express the type of how they're measuring how much virus they've got, because you can't simply look at a virus and say, are you living or death? Dead and poke it with a pin and see if it reacts. That's not the way viruses work, obviously. So I just want to point out that very frequently when you actually say how much virus you've got, you have to say what the assay is so that we know whether you're talking about virus which could go on to establish an infection or just virus particles which may not be able to do anything. So the living or dead explains some of the nomenclature, but the rest of it's philosophy. Okay, so we have viruses, and as I say, there are these sort of extreme things that are nucleic acid only or protein only, which come under this sort of kingdom, if you can call it such. But now I want to go back to the true viruses, and I'm going to concentrate on those. And I want to just mention virus classification. Virologists are sloppy taxonomists, so don't worry too much about learning genus names and species names, because we're really not too sure what a genera and what a species when it comes to virus. But it is useful to organise things, because if we organise things, then if we know that a particular virus belongs to the same family as another virus, we already have a good idea about how it works, what its weak points are, how it's likely to be transmitted. We may be wrong, but at least it gives us a good starting point. So, for example, when the hantavirus outbreak started a good few years ago now, people thought it might be a toxin, it thought it might be a very dangerous form of influenza because people were dying of respiratory disease and it first cropped up in the southwest. But when they went in, they found out that it was a member of the hantavirus group. And as soon as they found out that it was mapping to be a hantavirus, hantaviruses are typically transmitted by rodents. So then they immediately looked at the rodent population and lo and behold, they found it there. And then they know that hantaviruses are typically transmitted by rodents, by aerosolized urine. So you sweep up where rodents have been and you get this stuff in your lungs, and that's typically how it's transmitted. So the next thing that CDC does is it provides how you should do your housework if you live in the southwest and you have any kinds of rodents, which are extremely difficult to keep out in many places. So you go immediately from the molecular biology to housework advice on the CDC site. And I'm not joking. I mean, it's showing pictures of how you should sweep up a pile of rodent droppings. So these sort of things are important for rapid response and knowing what you've got and how to deal with it. So, and it's going to be even more important for you because, as I say, I really hope that viruses are going to be something that clinicians can diagnose and treat far more frequently than they currently do. And it's already improved massively over even 10 years ago. So how do we classify them? We classify them on the basis of the nucleic acid, and I'll go into that. The capsid, we've already talked about symmetry and so on, whether or not they have an envelope. And then if all those are the same, but we discover that the two sets of viruses that look identical are actually doing things very differently, we will then separate them out according to their replication strategy. So let me go into this in a bit more detail. Nucleic acid. As we go through, I hope you will eventually see why all of these really affect how a virus does things and how we can get back at the virus. Whether the virus is RNA or DNA has a big impact on how it approaches life. And I've already implied we use DNA as our genetic material. So viruses that use DNA as their genetic material can take advantage of a lot of our mechanisms for replicating DNA. We don't have mechanisms for replicating RNA. So if you're an RNA virus, you have to think of something else. Their nucleic acid may be segmented or non-segmented. And what that means is if we were in the everyday world, we'd say they may have one chromosome or multiple chromosomes. That's all it means. So it means your genome is divided amongst multiple segments. That's what influenza has, and that explains a lot of why we get pandemics with influenza. So it's very important whether these are segmented or non-segmented. They may be linear or circular. They may be single-stranded or double-stranded. So the nucleic acid, whether it's DNA or RNA, you can have single-stranded or double-stranded ones. That has some impact, but it has particular impact when we come to talk about single-stranded RNA viruses, because if they got a single strand of RNA, that could be the same sense as message. In other words, it can function as message, in which case message is by definition positive or plus sense. Or the genomic RNA may be complementary to message, so that's called negative or minus sense. And we'll come to discuss how that affects the life cycle of these viruses, because it does. And it's just a logical extension of the properties of nucleic acids. So all of these have an impact on the genetics and the stability and various other aspects of these viruses. We've already talked about the capsid. So the symmetry of the capsid is used in classifying these. Are they icosahedral? Are they helical? Are they complex? If they're icosahedral, the number of capsomers is important. And as I pointed out yesterday, if you're in the same family, you're going to have the same number of pentons. There'll always be 12. And you're going to members of a family will all have the same number of hexons. So they've all got the same structure. And part of that is because like viruses are going to have like-sized virions, and they're going to lead a like-sized number of hexons in order to make the virion the right size to package their genome. So members of a family are going to have very similar genome lengths, and they're going to have very similar virus particles with similar numbers of hexons. And then the final thing is, are they enveloped or non-enveloped? And I've already pointed out, having an envelope means that you put your attachment protein in the envelope, not in the nucleic capsid. And having an envelope means that, by and large, you're very different handling from the point of view of hygiene. And then, as I say, if all things are equal and we discover that things that look alike behave differently when it comes to what they do, then we will split them out and put them according to the ones that are alike into two families with the same structure, nucleic acid, etc., but different replication strategy. Okay. Were there any questions on that? I mean, that's... So the thing is that you could classify viruses using all sorts of different properties of them, but the one that's turned out to be really useful is actually just using the basic molecular biology, because there is so many similarities. And once you know what you've got, you know what tools you need to develop to assay for them, to inactivate them, and so on. I have given you two tables which look like evolutionary trees, genetic trees, whatever, for the RNA viruses and the DNA viruses. These tables have got no basis in terms of relationship between these viruses. They're just a way to organize them. So you can organize them any way you like. But just so that you've got a way to organise them, I provided these two tables because I find them useful, and over the years I know that some of the people in the class have found them useful. But however you want to organise them, don't bother to memorise these for the sake of impressing people that you know the genetics of these viruses. That is just a way to organise the families. But what we do end up with in this particular way of putting them, the DNA viruses, you can divide them into the double-stranded, the single-stranded, and the complex. And it so happens that all of the DNA viruses that we're going to talk about are icosahedral. All the ones that infect humans are icosahedral, except for the pox viruses. Always except for the pox viruses. So that leaves us with all of these are icosahedral, and then you've got the double-stranded may be enveloped or non-enveloped, and they may have circular or linear DNA down here. But here, if you've got a DNA virus which is double-stranded, non-enveloped, icosahedral, with circular DNA, we have two groups of viruses that both have got those properties. They both got similar. They both got the same number of capsomers in their virion. They're both roughly the same size. They were formerly grouped together in one family, and then when we started understanding how they went about life, we discovered they're actually very different. So here we've got two families coming under the same thing, despite the fact that they look very similar. and what I've put here in blue, then they're not all of the things that come here, but I tried to put the families that you are going to be dealing with in this course so that this gives you a way to organise these in terms of classification. And again, a scheme for the RNA viruses, this is similar. Just that one thing to notice, that if we're looking at non-enveloped, non-enveloped RNA viruses are always icosahedral. We don't have any non-enveloped helical RNA viruses. So if you want to sort of clear out some things before you start memorising it, you can just try with it. And again, I put the families that you're going to be dealing with by and large here. Just throw it away if you don't like it. I've also put a glossary in at the back of the handout because it just concludes some terms that we use and that you may find in the textbook. I'll try and point out some alternative terms when I use them. If the glossary is any, again, like these two tables, if it's any use to you, use it, and if it's no use to you, recycle it, save a tree, whatever. Okay, so that's just the classification scheme. And as I say, it's put there, and all of the viral classification schemes are basically to try and make this useful. So that's the only reason, is to put things together so that we can actually use these as tools to organise our thinking about individual diseases and approaches to. Are there any questions? Okay. So we talked about virus structure, virus classification, which is heavily involved with virus structure. And now what I want to do is start to talk about the virus life cycles. Each virus family has a slightly different life cycle, but what I want to do is try and emphasise some of the common principles that they use. So I'm going to start off by just giving an overview of the life cycle before we go and focus in on individual viruses. So when we come to the basic steps in the viral life cycle, we have absorption. That's when they bind to that receptor on the cell. Once they bind to that receptor, they're still outside the cell. So they can't do anything until they actually get inside the cell because they're going to need our protein synthesis machinery. So they've got to get eventually right inside the cell. So they need to be taken up some way or other and get inside the cell so that they're actually in the cytoplasm or in the nucleus and they can actually do something. And so that's called penetration, the way that they actually get inside. And then, as one friend of mine once said, they have the same problem as the medieval knight. And that is, when you come in from the big outside world and you're all coated in your armour and everything, you can't do much about going about reproduction until you uncoat. If you keep your armour on, you've had it. So this shell is made to be really tough in the outside world and protect the virus. But when it gets in the cell, if it insists on being tough, nothing's going to happen. So these shells are very carefully built. They have to be really tough, really solid, and yet they have to fall apart at a moment's notice once they get inside the cell. So that's the trick of a virus, is how do they make this tough outside and weak inside? And one thing, of course, is that's why there are no covalent bonds in these particles. One way to make this really tough outside would be to have all your subunits tied together by covalent bonds. But if you do that, then when you get inside the cell, you've got a problem, is how do you fall apart? So the viruses are actually made to fall apart in some way or other, and I'm not going to discuss the mechanism for that for most of them, but they do have to do that, and that process is called uncoating. And then they're in the eclipse phase, and what the eclipse phase is, it's just like the eclipse of the moon. The moon is there, but you can't see it. And with a virus, when it's in the eclipse phase, the virus is in the cell, but you can't see it because there are no virus particles anymore. They've all fallen apart. So what you've now got is the genome is somewhere, the proteins are somewhere else. If you take that cell and try and get an infectious particle out of it, you won't get one because the virus is just in bits. So until you start assembling your first virus particle, you cannot find any infectious virus in these cells. That is a problem, because if viruses are actually in cells and not making new particles, many of our assays are to look for live virus particles or virus particles that can infect cell cultures. So if we can't find them, we don't know they're there. So it can be a problem. PCR has helped us enormously because now we can detect very small amounts of nucleic acid. So we can find their footprints now. But before we had PCR, eclipse was really eclipse. We couldn't find them, but they were there. So the end of the eclipse phase is when you assemble your first new virus particle. While they're in the eclipse phase and beyond, they are synthesizing virus nucleic acid, virus protein. Now, many of these viruses produce thousands and thousands of infectious virus particles per cell. So you're going to make huge amounts. So if you're one of these kind of viruses that makes these huge amounts of virus particles, then, for example, I talked about rotaviruses. Rotaviruses produce so many virus particles per cell, and so many cells are infected, that if you look in a stool specimen of somebody with a rotavirus diarrhea, you can actually just put it in the microscope and see virus particles. There's so many there, which also actually means you can look for the antigen, which is how you can do the rotavirus testing. They're producing so much virus, as tiny as these things are, there's just so many. So you have synthesis of virus. So what you tend to do is make huge amounts of message, or what many of these viruses do, make huge amounts of message, so they make huge amounts of protein, assemble huge amounts of virus particles. And in doing so, they usually damage the cell if they're that sort of virus. And then they finally get all their nucleic acid and protein together, and then there's some kind of assembly process. Obviously, this is driven by a series of automatic assembly processes, and you assemble these nice capsids, and then they have to be released. Assembly process may be as simple as just putting the two things together, and now you've got the virus particle. But for many of these viruses, there's a maturation stage, and we'll go into that a bit. And then they're going to be released. So these are the standard steps of the virus life cycle. I'm going to go through several virus life cycles over the next few lectures, but just try and keep an overall point of view that this is what all of them are doing. We're largely going to focus on the things where we can get at these viruses. So some of these I'm going to go through fairly sketchily, or part also because some of them we don't really know. But this is the standard steps. All the viruses go through these. Maturation, maybe, maybe not. Okay, so I'll just go again. We're still talking about very broad principles at the moment, but just so that you've got the life cycle locked in your mind when we go into these individual details. Absorption. So the virus particles floating about in the medium, and then sooner or later, if it's going to be successful, it will hit the surface of the cell. So down here is a cell, and this is the plasma membrane with stuff in it. So the virus particle comes, and the attachment protein on the outside of the particle binds to one of these receptors. The receptor on the cell surface can be any component of the cell surface. So it can be a lipid, it can be a lipoprotein, it can be a polysaccharide, a sugar residue, it can be any component of the cell surface. Now, which component it is will affect how many, what sort of cells these viruses bind to, as I alluded to yesterday. So whether or not the cell has the appropriate component is important. The process is temperature independent. It's just a ligand binding. It's non-covalent. It requires no kind of energy. So they just bind to these surface receptors and stick for a while. They eventually fall off, but their hope is they're going to get in before they fall off. So they're temperature independent. It requires the viral attachment protein, and the viral attachment protein is always a protein because the virus doesn't make its own lipids. So whatever binds to it has got to be something the virus can code for, so it codes for protein. So the virus attachment protein is always protein, but it can bind to any kind of component at the cell surface. But for a particular virus, it will be the same component. Okay, so that's absorption. So it's now sticking to the cell surface. And now it's got to get inside. And as I say, if these viruses don't get inside, eventually they'll just dissociate again. It's just a ligand-receptor interaction. It's reversible. Now, penetration, we have to separate for penetration whether they're enveloped or non-enveloped in order to talk about them. And then if they're enveloped, they've got two ways in. Some enveloped viruses just go directly across the plasma membrane, and we'll talk about those first. And others are taken up by vesicles, and then they get inside the cell, and then they get into the cell. And we'll just talk about it because it does have a slight difference on the properties of these viruses. Okay, so penetration. Virus bound to the receptor. Now, what happens here is that once these viruses bind to these receptors, there are interactions that take place, conformational changes, and the virus gets sort of pulled closer to the cell surface. And because of this, the two membranes become very closely aligned. They're both host cell plasma bilayer lipid membranes. And what eventually happens is this will fuse with this. And the viruses do contain something that facilitates this fusion. So under these circumstances, the viruses contain something that facilitates, and it's a protein in the envelope, that facilitates the fusion of two lipid bilayers. And it will facilitate the fusion of any two lipid bilayers. It's not specific because, as I say, these membranes are our membranes. So but in this case, it's specific because it's in the right place to facilitate the fusion of a viral membrane and a host cell membrane. So fusion occurs, and the two lipid membranes become contiguous with each other. And if I was to take the left-hand side and the right-hand side and just pull it apart, then you would get this. So what happens is that viral membrane becomes a part of the host cell membrane. The old viral proteins, which included the attachment protein, are also a part, but it's a very small part. But it is a slight footprint, but it's a very small footprint, so we don't usually have a huge reaction to it. And the nuclear capsid is already in the cytoplasm. Simple. So this is a way to uncoat. You remove the envelope, and to get into the cytoplasm in one easy step. You might think that a lot of viruses would use it. It seems dead simple. Actually, only a few do. And the few that do are herpes viruses, paramyxoviruses, and HIV. And this actually is important because it's part of the pathology picture. And when I talk about herpes, I'll explain why. But these viruses that do this actually have an ability to create giant cells for a reason we'll come to later. And so it is a part of their pathology. So this you need to remember. So also the thing is that you have left a footprint in the cell membrane so that if you've got a really acute immune system, it might say, hey, somebody's been here, let's get rid of this. So the other way that these envelope viruses can get in is they enter via the endosomes. Now, if I can just go back to this. For this to work, the fusion protein has to work under the conditions on the outside of the cell. And for most of these viruses, obviously that's going to be physiological pH, which is, I guess, around pH 7.4 or so, or it's around pH 7. So it's frequently said neutral pH or physiological pH, but for the purposes of this, we regard those as equivalent. So if it causes fusion at physiological pH, it can get across this membrane. But supposing it doesn't cause fusion at physiological pH, how does that work? Well, that works by this, because when you enter via endosomes, endosomes become acidified when they, and then these fusion proteins work at acid pH. So they don't work at the cell surface because the cell surface, by and large, isn't acid. And so they wait until their fusion protein doesn't work until they get into an acid environment. So the principle is much the same, but they bind to a receptor, and now instead of immediately fusing and getting into the cell, they get taken up by a vesicle of some sort, and there's a whole pile of vesicle pathways, and different viruses are taken up by different ones, and I'm just talking about these as generalities. The vesicle then is pinched off and gets into the cytoplasm. There's a hydrogen ion pump in the vesicle membrane, so they become acidified. Once they're acidified, that fusion protein now becomes active and can facilitate fusion, and we have the same thing. The vesicle membrane becomes continuous with the viral membrane, and the nucleocapsid can now get out. So it gets out into the cytoplasm, and it can then go off and do its thing, and meanwhile, you're left with a vesicle which has got a bit of the viral membrane inserted into it, but that's not visible from outside the cell. So what this means is, one, this requires energy. So these viruses will only be taken up by acidified cells. They don't waste their time by, will only be taken up by living cells, because only the living cells will endocytose them. So they don't waste their time by actually just popping into cells which turn out not to be suitable. So they don't go into dying cells, although hopefully most of our cells are pretty healthy. So they're taken up. The other thing is these vesicles tend to take them further into the cell so that they don't have to make their way. Many cells have got this huge forest of skeletal stuff close to the plasma membrane. And getting across that, it can be a bit of a barrier, and that's been shown experimentally. So these vesicles give you a free ride into the cell, and you don't have to fight your way through it. The vesicles take you in. And also, you don't leave traces in the cell membrane. And the vast majority of viruses use this method to get in. So it's only a few viruses that use the other. Any questions on that? Okay, let me just see what... Okay, so this is just a picture of that process. This is an enveloped virus. What I didn't say when I talked about these envelopes is when viruses get an envelope, you can actually get sort of roughly two classes of envelope, and there's no official classification. But one is you get kind of a big, loose carrier bag, plastic bag type around you, and you're big and floppy, and you look a mess in the electron microscope. And the other thing is you can be shrink-wrapped. So if you've got a shrink-wrapped nucleocapsid, the virus is the shape of the nucleocapsid, but it does have an envelope, but it's very tightly applied to the nucleocapsid. This virus is actually a shrink-wrapped icosahedral nucleocapsid. And it's binding to a coated pit on the cell surface. It's being taken up by endocytosis here and here, and then it's being pinched off. Of course, these are electron microscope pictures, so everything's dead in these. So they've just taken nice pictures and put them in an order for you. But this is what we believe is the order of things as they happen. So with that seems to be a good place to leave viral penetration, and then we'll deal with the non-envelope viruses after the break. Are there any questions? Okay.